live a consistent life, but there are times, time to time, where my life doesn't match the things that I say I believe. Maybe you have been in the same place. You really work hard, you really try hard, but I don't know, it just seems like something pulls you the wrong way. And what I've learned over the years is that hypocrisy is contagious. Hypocrisy is contagious in that sometimes the way I act influences the way other people act. I've noticed that Maddie, especially, whenever I'm driving, if somebody does something crazy in front of us, she's like, "You're an idiot. Come on, what are you doing?" You know, and I'm thinking, she needs to quit watching her mom drive. Okay, so that's me, and I realize that hypocrisy is contagious, and people look at me, and they live their lives sometimes based on how I live my life, and I've got to be careful, because that can be contagious. But, so can faithfulness. Faithfulness can be contagious just as well. And if I live my life being a disciple of Jesus, allowing the Holy Spirit to work in me and to lead and guide me, then there are times where people can watch my example. And if they model themselves after me because I'm modeling myself after Christ, then it's going to help them. It can be contagious to them as well. So really it's about a choice. The choice is, am I going to be a hypocrite? Or am I going to be faithful? Choice is, am I going to be in control, or am I going to allow the Holy Spirit to be in control? So speaking of choices, I have something I want to do this morning, and I need somebody to help me. I need somebody that's at least in decent shape. Is there anybody? Kyle, would you help me out? You're such a good volunteer. I appreciate it. You weren't near as excited as I thought you would be. There you go. All right. This is Kyle. Everybody say hi, Kyle. Okay, I've got something that I want you to do. Well, actually, I've got two options. Okay, I'm going to give you the two options, then I'm going to allow you to decide what you would like to do. Okay, in my pocket, I have a $10 bill. Okay, it's a real $10 bill. Would you like to have this $10? No. Oh, no, you don't want to know. I let you touch that. Okay, would you like $10? Okay, all right, if you want $10, I've got two options for you. Option one is simply this. I need you, in the next 5 minutes, to do 1,000 push-ups. Okay, now listen, I'm not talking the little knees down girly push-ups. I'm talking the for real, you got to do the push-ups like a man push-ups. All right, 1,000 push-ups in the next 5 minutes. All right, that's option one, okay? Option two is to do absolutely nothing. To just ask me for the $10. You can have the $10 and you can go back to your seat. Okay, now, I'm going to give you a chance to just think about your options, okay? Because this might be a hard decision. So you go ahead and think about, do you need time to think? All right, let me review. Option one, 1,000 push-ups right here in the next 5 minutes. Option two is just ask for $10 and you have to go back yourself. So, which do you want to do? You don't want it at all? Oh, you want it. So you want option two. So $10 for nothing. All right, there you go. Thanks a lot. Enjoy. You guys are clapping. Why are you clapping? Because you're going down. Then you look at it and go, that's the dumbest choice I've ever seen in my life. Was there any of you that are like, you know what, for the challenge, I'm going to 1,000 push-ups. Yeah, I'm glad nobody put their hand up because you would be lying if you said so. We look at that and we go, this is an absolutely no-brainer. We go, there, it's a choice, but there's really no choice at all. Why would I work for something when I can get it for free? Now, what in the world would the lesson be that I want you to learn from this? It's very simple. You ready? Work. Don't work. Accept grace. That's what I want you to get, okay? That's the lesson. Don't work. Accept grace. You may be thinking to yourself, what in the world are you talking about? Well, luckily, I don't have to explain this to you because Paul's going to explain it in Galatians chapter 3. So if you've got your Bibles, would you turn with me to Galatians chapter 3? And if you don't have a Bible, you can use one of the Bibles from the pew in front of you. It's going to be on page 824. But we're going to be in Galatians chapter 3 because Paul's going to talk to us all about choices. It's a big choice that we have to make. We're seeing a lot of that as we go through this series. But Galatians chapter 3, and let's begin with the first verse. Read along with me. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified. I'd like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by means of the flesh? Had you experienced so much in vain, if it really was in vain? So again I ask, does God give you His Spirit and work miracles among you by the works of the law, or by you believing what you heard? So also Abraham believed God and was credited to him as righteousness. Understand then that those who have faith are children of Abraham. Scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. So those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. As it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. Clearly, no one relies on the law as justified before God, because the righteous will live by faith. The law is not based on faith. On the contrary, it says the person who does these things will live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a pole. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Now, you may look at that and go, I don't see a whole lot of choice there. And yet, Paul is going to go back in and he's going to review and he's going to talk once again about this whole idea of faith versus the law. He's going to talk about this whole idea of either receiving salvation through Jesus Christ or receiving salvation by working hard enough and doing what we need to do in order to receive salvation. And so that's what this whole talk is going to be about. All this part of the letter that he wrote here. He's going to describe for us two different options. Just like I gave Kyle two options this morning, Paul is going to give two options to us as well. So let me illustrate it this way. Paul says you can be saved in two ways. The first way is simply you can be saved by faith. Okay, so option number one is faith. That's how you're saved. You're saved by grace through faith. All of that comes through Jesus Christ. And Paul says that faith, what comes along with faith, is a blessing. If you look back in verse 9, he says, so those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. Now you've got to remember, Paul's talking to a mixed audience here. He's talking to Gentiles who had been preaching to for some time and had planted these churches throughout Galatia. But then some Jews had come into the church. And so he's talking to both groups right now. And he says, listen, if you have faith like Abraham had faith, then you're going to be blessed. In fact, Scripture said Abraham believed and it was credited to him as righteousness. So option number one is faith. And along with faith comes a blessing. And here's what it involves. It involves surrender. If you're going to accept grace, if you're going to accept that grace through faith, then you have to surrender. You have to let go of being in control. And most of us like to be in control. We want to direct where our life is going, the path that we're going to choose. But if you are going to accept grace by faith, then you have to surrender. You have to surrender yourself to God's will, to listen to what God wants you to do. That's what Abraham did. God came to Abraham and said, Abraham, I want you to pack up all of your stuff. I want to get your family together, and I want you to move. And I'll tell you when you get to the place I want you to go. Abraham did not even know where he was supposed to be going, but he took off, and God was with him. He surrendered his life. He surrendered control. So option one is faith. It comes with a blessing if we're willing to surrender. Now, the other side of that, he says the other option that you have is obeying the law. Okay? And he just refers to that as works. And he says, if you will obey the law, it will be your works, the things that you do, then you can be saved. You can make yourself right with God. But here's the thing. that idea of works is actually a curse. Okay, the idea of salvation by works is a curse. Blessing, curse. Why is this a curse? Why would we look at this and go, that's a curse? Well, because where faith calls for surrender, works calls for perfection. Okay, if you're going to go with option two, if you're going to try to make yourself right with God by obeying the law, you have to be perfect in your obedience. You can't mess up. You can't miss even one step. You can't step over the line, not one time. You have to be perfect. So that is a curse. Okay, it's a curse. And he says it in verse 10, for all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse, as it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. Okay, so we've got our two options here. Our option is to be right with God through faith, or to be right with God through works, by obeying the law, by doing everything perfectly and never messing up one time. Now, this choice should seem as simple as the choice that Kyle made earlier. Okay, when you look at these two things, you should go, this is a no-brainer, I'm going with the faith. The faith comes with a blessing. And if I surrender, it's God. It's God working. It's God doing the things that needs to happen. And if I choose works, then I've got to be absolutely perfect. And it's going to come with a curse. The curse is to be perfect. And I already know I'm not perfect, so that's really not even an option. It should be that simple, but it's not. Why is it that we struggle between these two options? Why is it that we go back and forth? That's what Paul is talking about in this section. Why in the world are y'all going back and forth between faith and works? The reason is our flesh, our bodies, like to be religious. Okay, our bodies like to do religious things. We like to get dressed up and come to church. And we like to sing songs. Even meet around the Lord's table. We might like to go to Sunday school or to a Bible study or to a small group. Our bodies, our flesh, likes to do religious things because it makes us feel good. When we do religious things, we think I'm a religious person. And God loves religious people a little bit more. And so as we begin to do these religious things, well, then our flesh, our body, it loves to boast. And all of a sudden we begin to look and go, I have been to church 12 weeks in a row. Was sick one of those weeks. Came anyway. It was a beautiful day. I had other options. Somebody asked me to go somewhere and do something, but I didn't. 12 weeks in a row I've been at church, been around the Lord's table. And we begin to boast in the things that we do, and we say, you know, not only have I been here, but I've given. I serve in the children's ministry, God bless me. Down there with the little ankle biters. That's what I did on a Sunday. You know what else I did? I greeted people at the door. I told them how happy we were to have them at church. I mean, I am giving of myself. And when we left, there were offering containers on both sides. I put money in both. We begin to boast in who we are. Our flesh, our body likes to do that. A little bit later on, Paul, in chapter 6 of this letter, he's going to say, I should never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. But when we do religious things, it allows us to be able to boast, and we get excited about all of those things that we do. We get excited about the works that we're involved in. And then our flesh and our body likes to compare ourselves to other people. We like to look at all the things that we've done and go, man, I am so much farther ahead than this group of people. I am so much more of a religious person than the rest of my family. I am so much closer to God than most anybody that I know. And so we start that comparison game again. We say, God, look at all the stuff I've done. That's why you should love me. That's why you should forgive me, because I've worked. I've done all of this stuff to earn your love and your forgiveness. But what we've got to remember, family, is the law was never given as a means of salvation. God didn't give the law so we could go, okay, I've got my checklist in front of me and I'm going to be perfect the rest of my life. If I obey by working, I'm going to be right with God. That's not why the law was given. The law was given to show us what sin is. To teach us what sin is. To teach us how far we are from being the people that we need to be in order to have a relationship with God. So Paul says you've got these two options. You can be right with God by faith, which has a blessing attached to it. And all you've got to do is surrender and allow God to work. Or option two, it's the law, it's works, it's doing. And it's a curse because you have to be perfect and there's not anybody that's perfect. You may think you're real close. You may go, Tim, if you knew me, you would realize how close I am to perfection. But close is not close enough because it calls for perfection. So Paul lays that out for him. Now what I want us to do is I want us to go back to the first part of what we read, the passage that we read, because then he's going to call on their experiences. And he's going to say, I'm going to lay it down for you. I'm going to tell you how it was in the Old Testament. I'm going to tell you how faith began with Abraham when he trusted God. And so he started this ability that those who will trust in God can be right with him. Wasn't because Abraham did everything God said. It was because he had faith in him and he trusted him. And now he wants us to look at our own experience. Would you go back and look at verse 1 again? He says, you foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Okay, who has deceived you? Paul would say to you and me today, who deceived you into thinking you've got to be religious? That you've got to work, that you've got to earn your salvation, God's love and God's forgiveness. He'd say, who's deceived you into that? He continued, before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was portrayed as crucified. He said, there was nothing hidden in my message. I preached to you Jesus Christ crucified, and that's how your relationship with God is restored. Through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He says that was very clear, but somebody has deceived you. And you've gone away from faith right back into works. I've got to do things for God. Verse 2, I would like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by believing what you've heard? He says, did you get the Holy Spirit because you worked for it? Or did you receive the Holy Spirit because of faith? He says, are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by means of the flesh? He says, okay, when I preached to you and you accepted the message of Jesus Christ, you did that in the Spirit, and now you're going to go back to this? Now you're going to listen to people when they say you need to be circumcised, you need to practice religious festivals like the Jews, you need to wash your hands a certain way, all of these things. You're going to go back to that when you started with the Spirit and that's what you were taught? That's what I showed you? I don't understand that. Verse 4, have you experienced so much in vain? If it really was in vain. So again I ask, does God give you His Spirit and work miracles among you by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? What He's asked them to do is to look back in their life. He says, look back at the changes that have happened in your life, and did that happen because you worked hard enough? Or did that happen because of the Spirit of God? Because of the grace that God poured out onto you through faith? Which was it? And he uses the word miracles. Did you see that? He said, these miracles that happened in you, did they happen by the Spirit or did they happen because you worked hard enough? And maybe you're wondering, well, Tim, there's been no miracles in my life. Okay, I haven't been sick and been miraculously cured. You know, I haven't been in debt and miraculously I go to the mailbox and there was just $100,000 in an envelope for me. What are the miracles that you're talking about? Well, I think in our own church family here, we can see miracles. Because there were some that could say, I was addicted. Drugs, alcohol, all kinds of things. I was addicted, but now I'm saved by grace. Others can say, I was consumed by pornography. Pornography was a part, it was something I thought about every day, many times during the day. But I have been free from that. I have been saved by grace. Others in our family can say, I was an adulterer. I stepped out on my marriage. I had a relationship with somebody else that was supposed to be saved for just the relationship I had with my spouse. I was an adulterer, but now I'm saved by grace. Others can say, you know what? I love money more than I love my family, more than I love my friends, more than I love my church. I just loved money. But now, I'm saved by grace. There's others in this church family that can say, you know what? I was a glutton. Everything I did was to excess. Everything. I went over the top. Whether it was eating, whether it was drinking, whether it was working, whether it was a hobby. Everything I went to excess on. I was a glutton. But now, I'm saved by grace. Family, if you don't think those are miracles, you don't understand what a miracle is. Because God has done for people in this church, God has done for people in my family, what we could never do on our own. Paul says, look at your own experience. When you look at your life, are things better because you worked really hard? Or are things better because you surrendered yourself to Jesus Christ? You allowed your faith to come through. And you were blessed because of it. And toward the end of this section, in this section that we read, he's going to tell us why these miracles happen. He's going to tell us why he teaches Jesus. And that's his main concern, is making sure they understand Jesus. And it's our key verse. It's in Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, would you look at verse 13? It says, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who's hung on a pole. Or that can be translated, cursed is anyone who is hung on a tree. What we're talking about here is the cross. And Paul says, Jesus redeemed us. And that word redeem means to purchase a slave for the purpose of setting them free. Okay, now if you studied history at all, even slavery in other countries, slavery in the United States, you know that you could purchase a slave. You could purchase a slave and you could use them as a slave. But to redeem a slave means you bought them because you're going to set them free. You're going to purchase them not so they can work for you and serve you, but you can set them free and say, okay, go. You are now free. Live life as a free man. Paul says that's what Jesus Christ did for us. How did he do that? Jesus redeemed us by becoming a curse. Okay, Jesus became a curse for us. How did he become a curse? By going on the cross. Because if you read in the Old Testament in Deuteronomy, it says, anybody that's hung on a tree, anybody that's hung on a pole, in other words, what we think about anybody hung on a cross, it's horrible. They are cursed. They are disgraced. And so Jesus became a curse. The curse of perfection. Jesus was perfect. He became that. He embodied that curse. And he took care of it on the cross. So that you and I don't have to live perfect. You and I don't have to try to justify ourselves to God. This is why you should love Him. This is why you forgive Him. The reason He should love and forgive us is because we've accepted the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. And that's the only thing that matters. So why, family? Why would we go back to this? Once we have experienced accepting Jesus Christ, once we've experienced surrendering ourselves to God and saying, God, I am not perfect. I will never be perfect, but I want to have a relationship with you. So please make me right through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus.
When we give ourselves to Christ, we're baptized into Him. Our sins are forgiven. We receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the first time in our lives, maybe we feel clean. We feel okay. Once we've experienced that, why do we go back here? Why do we go back and say, but God, listen, I go to Sunday school. God, I know I'm a horrible person at work. I know I cheat on my time. I know that I treat other employees bad. I know I'm a horrible boss, but God, I gave money in the offering last week. God, I know I love stuff. I know I love to work. I love money. I love hobbies. I love all of these things. I know that I love them more than I love my family. I know I spend more time with them than I do my family, but God, listen, I took the Lord's Supper today. When I went to church, God, I did what you said. Jesus said whenever we come together that we should remember His body and His blood, and so that's what I did. And we go back to feeling like we've got to earn God's love. God poured out everything that He had through His Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross. You've got two options, family. It's either the option of faith, allowing Jesus Christ to take care of your curse, to allow the Holy Spirit to work in you, or it's just try to work and be good. To try to be perfect every day of your life so you can come before God like a little child and say, but here's what I did for you, God. Here's all the good things, and so you should love and you should forgive me. When you look at it, family, is it really a choice? It's no choice, right? See, the thing is, don't work. Accept grace. Okay? Don't work. Accept grace. Don't work.
Accept grace.
It's that easy. Paul says to that church, listen, that's what it's all about. It's about the message of Jesus that I've preached to you, that I've shared with you since I've come and been a part of your journey. So family, you have a choice to make today. You have a choice to make of whether you're going to be perfect or whether you're going to surrender. That's the choice. Perfection or surrender. I don't think I'm going to have to convince you that perfection is not an option. So if you can't do that, then simply surrender. What's amazing about when we surrender is that God does things in us and through us that we never imagined were possible. There are addictions and conditions and issues that God can bring us through that we've tried for years to bring ourselves through, and we've been unsuccessful. And when we surrender, God can do great things through us. So this morning, as we go into our decision time, as we worship some more, I want you to make a choice today. Make a choice, faith or works. How are you going to live your life? Because if you choose works, man, you're going to be defeated. Because you'll come back next Sunday, and you'll walk in here and you'll go, doggone it, I wasn't perfect again. Man, I wasn't perfect again. But here's all these things I did do, and I came to church. Or you choose faith and you go, you know what? I wasn't perfect this week. What's amazing is God's continued to forgive. And He's healing. And He's teaching me. And I'm actually doing better. Now people are beginning to watch me. And they're saying, how did you overcome that? And I say, well, because I have faith in Jesus Christ. Because Jesus is working. So make a choice tonight. Maybe the choice you need to make today is to accept Jesus for the first time. Because if you've never accepted Jesus, you don't know what the cross is about. You don't know the cleansing that can come. You need to accept the Lord. How about doing that today? But if you've already accepted Him, you still daily make that choice. Faith or works. Listen, I'm giving you an out. Don't work. Accept grace. Because we're saved by grace through faith. Maybe you need us to pray for you this morning. We'd love to do that. If you want to come forward, we'll pray for you publicly. If you say, no, I don't want to get in front of all those people, find me after the service. I'll pray with you privately. We'd love to do that as well. Or maybe you're here and you say, I want to be a part of this church family. I want to work. I want to serve. I want some accountability. If you're a baptized believer, we'll welcome you into our family. We'll love having you as a part. But the choice is yours. You decide today. Is it faith and surrender? Or is it works and perfection? It's really not a choice, but you need to choose. So as we sing, let God speak to you today. And if there's a choice you need to make, why don't you make it? Would you stand with me? Let's worship.